First of all, let me explain how I am a total misfit. In the first place, I am not as young as all these young people. Second place, I am not an authority in tourism in any way. Thirdly, I do not travel half as much as most people that I am hearing about, maybe much less than that. Now the big question is, so why am I here? Well, I'll briefly start by saying that I do agree with the point that sustainability is a matter of great concern. Yes, it is. And the whole problem is that just round the corner, we have a session with Kolkata police, and the session is about why wearing helmet is required. Not only that, we have also collaborated with Royal Enfield, and Royal Enfield says that all those students who attend this seminar, out of that 100 students, if they have a license in their own name and they don't have a case against them for rash driving, we will give them all a helmet of 2,800 rupees absolutely free of cost. Now, the problem is that we are not getting 100 young boys like that. Can you believe that? We are talking about a college like Bhavanipur Education Society College. We don't have 100 students who can say that, sir, I have a license in my name. I have never had a case against me. And I all the time wear the helmet. I am not caught for rash driving. I don't get into no entries. There is no problem that I've had. 100 people you don't get. The whole point is, so what does now the Calcutta police do? So Calcutta police tries to conduct sessions in colleges to sensitize the youth. So you see, that is how important it is. Law is there in its place. But regardless of the law, things just don't work. Because unless people are sensitized, even law does not work. Now the big question is, that do we need the law at all? Now I have been teaching law for many years, and therefore that's how I also came across Rupanjana. I can tell you that if you go back to 1844, that was a time when one law was invented because it was not natural. We had this law called the Companies Act. It's called Joint Stock Companies Act in the United Kingdom. And that was roughly the time when the company form of business in some concept started. Now the whole big question is, before that, how was business being done? Business was being done the way business would happen. That's it. It was natural. You are a proprietor. Maybe you'll join hands with somebody, become a partner and do the business. That's basically how it went. If today we recount the result of that law which started, so it appeared to be a curb. It appeared to be some kind of a stipulation. That okay, now business has to be done like this. If you are bringing too many people, then this has to be done, that has to be done. So to begin with, nobody liked it. Okay, my God, now law is there. If you want to do big scale business, then you have to comply with the law. What is the status today after when we are talking about 200 and, or not 200 years, less than that, 175 odd years back. So in 175 years, where are we today? You find that things are pretty well regulated and the organization have grown, corporates have become bigger, and everybody starts thinking that instead of a partnership, why not go for a company form? There is ambition and there is, I think, positivity about doing business and entrepreneurship all around. Today we are talking about a completely different part of that law which has come. Today we are talking about something like, in case of bankruptcy also, how do you handle those matters? So entrepreneurship has taken a complete different level. So my small submission is, and I would like to be told about the experts who are present over here, although I am aware that there are laws, there are regulations to take care of sustainable development of tourism and taking care of this law and that law, but they are all piecemeal. Do we have a comprehensive legislation? Well, I was just doing a small bit of research, and I didn't come across anything like that. Although there is a policy, there is a tourism policy, but do we have a comprehensive law like we have a law to regulate the operations of business? Can we have that kind of a thing? That is one question. So I leave you with some thoughts. That's one. The second thing I discovered, and I'm just sharing something that you could also discover, that the United Nations, and I'm concerned and I'm thinking a lot about United Nations these days, because we have something called a modern United Nations, MUN, that's happening around the corner in the college. And had I thought about it earlier, maybe this would have been one of the agendas. So what happens in a modern MUN, all of you all might have participated in Model United Nations, and in fact I invite all of you all to join in. It's happening on the 5th, 6th, 7th and 8th of September in our college. So all students are welcome to join in. So what happens here is that international issues are debated by the youth, all of you all. And there is UN has this body called World Tourism Organization, something like that, WTO they call it. Incidentally, it's also WTO. It's not the World Trade Organization, but it also is WTO. And that could have been a matter of, but what they are trying to do through this is that they are trying to again build consensus, which is required. For example, if we just have a law here, then that law will not be in sync with the law that is there in UK. And I found that UK has done a small amount of work, good amount of work actually, something that can be emulated. They also have a legislation passed in 1969, which they are quite seriously following. There are countries in the world who are doing it. Queensland, for example, is doing it. How can we have a comprehensive legislation to avoid a lot of problems that happens when we don't care about sustainability? And therefore, I do believe that some kind of, and keeping a drawing a parallel from the way companies have developed after the regulations came in, and they were not a curb, but they were actually developmental. So it seems that, is it restrictive or is it developmental? So it's well developmental, without any doubt. So the same kind of experience could also come in. It's a very simple thing. All forms of discipline are like that. If you're playing, learning how to play the piano, then there are rules that you have to follow, and you feel that, my God, it's so much of restriction. You can't do this, you can't do that. But once you learn the discipline of the instrument, then music comes. It's like that. So unless we discipline ourselves, I do not think that sustainable music from the industry of tourism is going to happen. I think we need to sensitize ourselves, we need to learn the games, we need to give ourselves the rules. And I think that we are all probably going to arrive at a consensus. The younger generation comes together and they can sensitize, they can debate, and they can arrive at conclusions. It happens. And what happens at the MUN, as all of you all know, is that you can pass resolution and the resolutions can go directly to the UN WTO. We can, that is the, if that is a kind of work that is possible. So I think as youngsters, that is one of the initiatives that can be probably taken. We can also think about whether it is possible, the moment it comes under the realm of some kind of regulatory provision, whether it is possible that financial assistance can be claimed. Because so quite often it so happens, say for example, micro small industries, they were not in any form, they were not in any structure, but now you have a ministry which takes very serious care of it, and you have so many provisions there where even a person who does not have adequate papers can get assistance and he can start a micro industry. That is the status now. So once you have a structure, then a person who might be, because tourism has a great employment potential, I think we must all understand that. A huge potential is there and employment is already happening. But the people who are employed in the industry, they don't know what they are supposed to do and they are not supposed to do. Few people might be selling tea, and those tea, that tea also must be going to tourists most of the time. I think we are in the right time because such people have become Prime Minister of the country. So therefore, this is probably the right time that we talk about it very seriously, and whether the disorganized and the unorganized sector, which also caters to the tourism industry, whether they can also somehow be brought under some form of discipline, as I just mentioned a little while ago. If that can be done, I think we've got a huge, huge road ahead. It's probably the sector, as the previous speaker just said, that there are states who thrive on tourism and tourism alone. And there are countries which are only on tourism or largely on tourism. Well, if we talk about the facts, some facts which I could discover was that we had something like in 2014, we had something like 56 lakh tourists. And that was the international tourists I'm talking about. The target used to be that by 2020, we will be having 156 lakh.